Hey y'all, my name is Prashanth Kumar, or PK, and I'm an MCAT tutor at Shemmassian Academic Consulting. Today, we're going to be doing a passage walkthrough in the MCAT Chem Phys section. You should be taking roughly 6.5 minutes on this passage, but today we're going to go more in depth so you can see exactly what's going on in my head as I take on this passage. Let's get it. All right, great. So I've gone ahead and put the passage on the left and the questions we're going through on the right. So feel free to take a moment and pause the video. If not, let's get right into talking strategy. For me, I like to maintain the same strategy going into whatever passage I'm going to take. The reason for this is it gives me something to ground myself in. Whether the passage is super easy or super challenging, I always have something to come back to. My strategy looks like reading a paragraph, writing a quick 3 to 5 word summary, and then going on to the next paragraph, and so on until I'm done. The reason I like to do this is that this provides me accountability in making sure I understand what's going on in a paragraph before moving on to the next paragraph. By doing this, I prevent a lot of time from being wasted when instead of having to reread it, I might not have to reread an entire passage, I can reread just a paragraph if necessary. So that little accountability is very, very important to me. And finally, when I usually look at passages, I don't want to spend too much time on the figures because I don't know what questions will be asked about the figures, but I will need to come back to them eventually if they do ask questions. So I'm prioritizing just taking a quick glance and understanding what's going on rather than spending too much time on the details of experiments or graphs or whatever. So with that, let's get right into our first paragraph. Researchers are interested in studying a novel optical system to model the human eye. The experimental setup includes a lens, object, and image. The object is placed at various positions relative to the lens in order to produce different images. All right, so the question I always ask myself is, what's happening? We're looking for a big picture understanding of what's being done. And so here, we have an example of an eye model with a lens, object plus image. Okay, so those are the quick summary of what's going on in the paragraph. Remember, use abbreviation, use symbols, use whatever you need to make sure it's simple and easy to understand for you, and you're not wasting too much time. No one else is going to check this little summary you write. So with that, let's go on to the next paragraph. In experiment one, the experimental setup appears as shown in figure one. The object is located at position O, the image is located at position I, and the focal length of the lens is shown at position F. So right away, I can see that this isn't giving me much, right? This little blurb doesn't really have that much information, so we're gonna have to look at the figure. And this goes against my usual tip, right? And that's fine, it's a tip, it's supposed to be flexible. So here, we see a diagram, right? We see an experimental setup of an object, a lens, and an image. And we've seen these types of graphs before in our content review phase. And this is called a thin lens, or anything in optics is dealing with these types of setups, okay? So I just want you to pay attention to a couple of important things, namely, where's the object and where's the image, and how far away is that from the lens with respect to the focal distance, okay? So here, I'm gonna mark everything. So this is the focal distance, this is the object distance, and this is the image distance, okay? And so what I want to focus on is how the object distance and image distance are effectively related to the focal distance. So here I'm going to say the object distance is actually greater than the focal distance, and here I'm going to say the image distance is greater than the focal distance as well, right? We see the focal distance is pretty small comparative to both of them. And that's all I want to take away from this paragraph. Next, we'll go on to the second experiment. In experiment two, the researchers adjusted the position of the object, resulting in a different location of the image. The experimental setup appears as shown in figure two. And then they give us a graph, right, of this experimental setup. And what I want you to note is the same exact thing, right? This is a similar graph as what we've seen in figure one. But what changes, right? So in this case, our object distance is greater than F, but our image distance is less than F, okay? So right away, we have a bunch of information that we're working on. And we have the same sort of parameters that we looked at in figure one compared to figure two. Finally, let's go on to the last paragraph. In experiment 3, the researchers once again adjusted the position of the object. The experimental setup appears as shown in figure 3. And so here we have our final sort of figure, right? We had three different experiments with three different object distance changing. So in this case, how is the object distance related to the focal length? Well, the object distance is less than the focal length, and the image distance is greater than the focal length, okay? So those are the main things I want to focus on right now. Other details you can note is where the image distance is related to the object distance. So here I'm gonna, you could write image opposite, and then image same, right? You don't have to do that, but if you wanted to pay attention to that, that's something we can always work with. Awesome. So with that, let's get right into questions. Which of the following determines the focal length of the lens in figure 1? Is it A, the radius of curvature of the lens, B, the image distance, the C, the object distance, or D, the level of lens magnification? All right, so right away, this is a standalone question, one that we're not gonna require any prior information for. So what is their answer gonna be? Well, we should know a focal length, this value right here, F, is an intrinsic property of the lens. Focal length equals intrinsic property, so of the lens. And so that means if we change the lens, that is going to change the focal length. But what is the defining property of the lens? It's the radius of curvature of the lens. So A is our answer. Let's go through B, C, and D. B is the image distance. That, while it is affected by the lens, it's also affected by the object distance. And so that does not determine focal length. C, object distance. This does not affect focal length. It's actually independent of focal length because you're changing the distance. It's going to change, not going to change the focal length at all. So C is eliminated. And then D, the level of lens and magnification. If you remember the formula, magnification is equal to negative image distance over object, right? And so with that, we can eliminate that as a choice because it's dependent on image distance and object distance, which both are not solely determined by focal length. So right away, we're one for one, just from understanding a piece of information that we already had. Awesome. Question number 2. In experiment 1, suppose the object distance is 2 centimeters, and the image distance is 3 centimeters. What is the focal length of the lens? Is it A, 1/2 centimeters, B, 3/4 centimeters, C, 6/5 centimeters, or D, 7/9 centimeters? All right, so right away, we have to note that we're looking at experiment 1, okay? So that's this diagram right here. And so we have our object distance, our image distance, and it tells us what exactly we're looking at, right? It tells us object distance is 2 centimeters, image distance is 3 centimeters, and focal length is what we're looking at. And so with this, we're gonna need a formula, right? We're gonna need a very important formula that we should remember from our content review. And that's the important thin lens equation. And what is that equation? Well, that's 1/object distance plus 1/image distance equals 1/focal length. Okay. So with this, we have an equation and we're ready to go. And so we just plug and chuck, right? We say, what is the object distance? 2 centimeters. So 1/2. And what is the image distance? 1/3 equals 1/focal distance. So now the question is, do the units match? That is always what we need to check. And it says centimeters, 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 centimeters. All the answer choices are in centimeters. And our object distance and image distances are also in centimeters. So we're looking good to go, and we're ready to run through our calculations. So what is 1/2 + 1/3? Well, that is finding the common denominator is 6. We have to multiply this by 3, and this by 3, and this by 2, and this by 2. Classic multiplication and addition. So then we have, 3 + 2. On the numerator and 6 on the denominator, which is equal to 5 over 6. But remember, this is equal to 1 over the focal length distance. What is going to be the focal length distance? It's not asking for 1 over f, it's looking for f. So with that, we do a little quick flip, right? If we flip this side, that means we flip this side. So f is equal to 6 over 5. And we have our final answer. And it matches C, right? So we don't have that matching A, B, or D, and we're good to go. Right away, our first calculation is dependent on the thin lens equation. This is a very high yield equation that will come up over and over again. So I want you to remember this one. All right, with that, let's go right on to question number 3. All right. Which of the following experiments produces a virtual equation, a virtual image? Is it A, experiment 1, B, experiment 2, C, experiment 3, or D, none of the experiments produce a virtual image? All right, so first to do this, we need to define what a virtual image is, right? A virtual image is an image created by what? Diverging rays of light. Image created by diverging rays of light. Awesome. Okay, so this is a contrast to our real image. We have real images that are created by sort of converging rays of light, and a virtual image is by diverging rays of light. And so with this, we have to understand what types of objects result in virtual images, right? We have convex mirrors, concave lenses. They always give us virtual images. This is guaranteed, right? Then we have to look at the vice versa, right? We have concave mirrors and convex lenses. And these will not always give us virtual images. Rather, they'll usually give us real images, except if the object distance is less than the focal distance. If the object distance is less than one focal distance, this results in a virtual image. So these are the rules for what gives you a virtual image. So with that, we have to look at all three of our experiments and decide which one's gonna get us a virtual image. All right, so right away, we see this type of lens, and we don't know exactly if it's a convex or concave lens, but we do know the distances, right? And we've written it so that we have O is greater than F, O is greater than F, and O is less than F. So with that, we already see a relationship between object distance and focal distance. And remember that regardless of whether a lens is a concave lens or a convex lens, if O is less than F, it will be a virtual image, okay? So remember, if O is less than F in these concave lenses, it will always be a virtual image. Even if O is greater than F, it will be a virtual image in a concave lens. So I just want to emphasize that this is always. But if you're in a convex lens and O is less than F, then you would have a virtual image. So the identifying factor of if it's a convex lens or a concave lens doesn't really matter. All that matters is that the object is within one focal distance of this lens, right? And so we don't know, remember, we don't know what the lens is. We don't know if it's a convex or concave lens. We just know it's a lens. But with the fact that this has O less than F, we can eliminate experiments A and B and just be left with C, right? Because we know that is our answer. That is a guaranteeing factor that is sufficient to determine that we will have a virtual image. So with that, on to question number 4. Oops. All right, question number 4. In experiment 2, suppose the image distance is increased. What effect would this have on the absolute value for the magnification of the lens? Would it A, increase, B, decrease, C, stay the same, or D, no change? All right, So this requires us to understand what is happening with magnification. And like we mentioned earlier, there's a specific formula I want you to remember for magnification. Okay? Magnification is negative image distance, or I, over object distance. All right, so in this case, our image distance is increasing. So they're basically saying, if we push this image distance further, what will happen to our magnification? And remember, it's saying the absolute value for the magnification. So what we do is we're just putting absolute value signs on both sides. So regardless of whether it's negative or positive, the output will be positive. All right, so with that, what effect would an increase on image distance have on the absolute value of magnification? Well, if we know fractions, right? If we increase the numerator while keeping the denominator same, this results in an increased value, okay? You can just think of it as like, if I had 1 over 2, that's 0.5, but if I just increase that to 2 over 2, that's 1. So we definitely see an increase in value. So if we increase the image distance, we would resultantly see an increase in magnification. So we can say that A is our answer. If we decrease the image distance or increase the object distance, then we would result in a decrease. So we can eliminate that. Staying the same, we would either not have to change anything or increase image distance and object distance at the same rate. So we can eliminate C, and then no change, same thing. We can eliminate D as well. All right, great work, team. We crushed another physics passage. Kudos for you for getting it done, dealing with thin lens equation, magnification, optics, all of that. So great job reviewing all of that material. If you like this video, give us a like down below and subscribe to our channel, and comment exactly what you're looking forward to in our next passage walkthrough. Also, check out our 528 strategy series from Vikram so you can maximize all your test-taking strategies on test day. And finally, hit the link in our bio to sign up for our MCAT question of the day so you don't miss out on any studying before test day. Happy studying and good work.